So, good morning. This is Pastor John at St. James Lutheran Church here in Fayetteville, North Carolina. We just concluded our worship service on Easter Sunday, and I wanted to do a little recording and welcome you here. This is our outdoor prayer garden, and as you can tell, the cross in the background, beautifully decorated with lilies and geraniums and azaleas. We've had a great crowd today, and it's been a wonderful time of worship. Today, though, as you see this video on YouTube, it's the second Sunday of Easter, Sunday where hope still lives and where joy is still the theme of the day. It is a time. It's a time of growth and resurrection. Resurrection is not easy. It's not always bouncing up and down on the sofa. It's not always whistling as we bounce down the sidewalk. Resurrection can take time. But there's hope. There's joy. We give you thanks for being here. We thanks the Synod staff of North Carolina Synod for creating this worship service for us so that many of the pastors in the Synod can take some break time. So be with us today in worship. Let us know that you're with us. If there's ways we can be of help and things we need to be praying for you, so let us know. Thanks for being here.
The Easter season is a week of weeks, seven Sundays, when we play in the mystery of Christ's presence, mostly through the glorious gospel of John's witness. Today we gather with the disciples on the first Easter, and Jesus breathes the Spirit on us. With Thomas, we ask for a sign, and Jesus offers us his wounded self in the broken bread. From frightened individuals, we are transformed into a community of open doors, peace, forgiveness, and material sharing such that no one among us is in need. Thank you. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Refreshed by the resurrection life we share in Christ, let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We thank you, risen Christ, for these waters where you make us new, leading us from death to life, from tears to joy. We bless you, risen Christ, that your spirit comes to us in the grace-filled waters of rebirth. Like rains to our thirsting earth, the streams that revive our souls, like cups of cool water shared with strangers, breathing your peace on your church when we hide in fear. Clothe us with your mercy and forgiveness. Send us companions on our journey as we share your life. Make us one risen Christ. Cleanse our hearts. Shower us with life. To you be giving all praise with the Holy Spirit and the glory of God, now and forever. Amen.
Our Kyrie and Canticle of Praise are from setting 6, which can be found in the front of your hymnal, beginning on page 165. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above, and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. This holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Almighty God, with joy we celebrate the day of our Lord's resurrection. By the grace of Christ among us, enable us to show the power of the resurrection in all that we say and do. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
This is a reading from Acts, the 4th chapter. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We hear these words from Psalm 133. How good and how pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity. It is like fine oil upon the head, flowing down upon the beard, upon the beard of Aaron, flowing down upon the collar of his robe. It is like the dew of Hermon flowing down from the hills of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore.
Gospel according to John, the 20th chapter. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. And if you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, unless I see the mark of his nails in his hand and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe. A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. And then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe. Thomas answered him, my Lord, my God. And Jesus said to him, have you believed because you've seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet come to believe. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you might come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The gospel of the Lord.
Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we praise and thank you, Lord, for giving us this life, for allowing us, Lord God, to live in the power of the resurrection. Help us this day to be stirred by your wonderful Easter story so that we might go out and share your good news, so that more people will be drawn to you, recognizing the gift they have in our Savior. And, O Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer. Amen. 2020 hindsight, to be able to look at this text today and to wonder how Thomas could have doubted. I think all through childhood and in different stories, versions of this text, there's been a lot of shame put on Thomas, a lot of things that conclude that Jesus was telling him that shame on you for not believing. I don't think that's what the text is speaking to us. I think the text is trying to show us God's promise and God's awareness of who we are. So we see the disciples. We come into the story and the disciples are hiding because they know the Jews want them dead. I think most of us would admit if someone was coming to get us, we would hide. We would go to the safest place possible, try to get probably as far away from them as we can and not want our location disclosed. So they've gone through this time period where they have been able to see all of the things that Jesus is able to do. But they also saw him die. They saw him crucified. And I don't blame them for not wanting that for themselves. But even in the midst of them trying to lock themselves up and to keep their lives safe, Jesus appears in the midst of them. Because God knows who we are, Jesus didn't simply appear and expect that they would know who he was, but he gave them evidence. Evidence that he did not need, but evidence that those who were there needed. Oftentimes in our life, I think God is aware of the ways that we need God to show us God's holy presence. God does not think that we have the faith to get through this because that's why God had to give us faith. Faith is a gift, not something we can muster up of our own volition. It's a gift. So God recognizes the need for faith to be gifted because God understands our human minds and our doubts. So oftentimes, I think God gives us ways of confirming that this is God speaking with me. Oftentimes, I'll ask people in their discernment, how do you usually know that you're on the right track? What does God do to confirm that? Some people say, I'll hear it from three different people, the same thing, maybe slightly different, but it's the same thing that's God's way of confirming. Some will see a rainbow or a bird or something in nature that confirms that this is God trying to get you to go in a different or new direction. Sometimes it's a particular family member. Maybe it's mom or grandma or even a child that is God's source of confirming that you are hearing from me. So as Jesus appears in the midst of the disciples in their time of self-quarantine, so to speak, Jesus comes in their midst and gives them the evidence. Put your hands here and here. And they knew that it was him. This gospel is written so that people will believe, so that people will be convinced about who God is, who Jesus is. And so this act, this willingness of Jesus to continue to allow our human frailty to be answered to in that moment, so that we might have access to the joy of faith. And so they touch him and they believe and they are excited that Jesus is with them. And Jesus declares, "Peace be with you." I wonder what it sounded like, what it felt like. I imagine that as they heard those words, there was something about their hearts that were discombobulated that began to ease. That they felt their muscles suddenly feel much lighter and less tight. I imagine that they could feel that as Jesus said those words, there was almost a tangible washing over them of God's holiness that reminded them of the peace they had when they journeyed with him. And then he breathes on them the Holy Spirit. He gifts them the advocate that had been promised. He allows them to feel God's holy presence through words and the Holy Spirit. Poor Thomas wasn't there. Poor Thomas was somewhere else when all of these things happened. So he didn't get to see firsthand as Jesus suddenly appears and shows his wounds, says these words of peace, and then uses his breath to be the Ruach in that moment, the very Spirit of God through the breath. So when they see Thomas, it's like, oh, guess what you missed? You won't believe this, but Jesus was here. Our Lord was here. Our rabbi was in our midst. Thomas like, yeah? You say so. I know there have been times when I've been convinced of something, that this is the way God is leading me. And if things don't go exactly in order or smoothly, there's a temptation to say, maybe that wasn't what I thought or heard. Thomas says, unless I see the mark, unless I see the nail marks in his hand, and the wound in his side, I won't believe. But remember, they've just told Thomas that they've seen it, that they've experienced it. So it's not that he thought of something out of whole cloth, but he wanted to experience what they experienced if he were going to believe. And because they had an encounter with the Holy, they were shifted in a way that only can be gained by having an encounter with God. I wonder if he could see their glow, if he could see their hearts change, if he could see the fear that had been so prevalent that caused them to hide, melting away from their faces. They must have shone somehow with God's glory and God's favor. So then Jesus comes back. And again, Jesus stands amongst them and says, "Peace be with you." I always think about that when we pass the peace. I wonder if people recognize the power of those words. Peace be with you. The peace of the Lord be with you. The peace of Christ be with you. In the present, right now, I am reminding you that God's peace is right now with you. when we hear those words, I don't think it is, it probably will be as impactful as Jesus saying them, but it ought to reconcile us with the relationship that we have with God. That no matter what happens to us in this life, that God is with us. And that should be the source of our peace. Not the lack of disruption, not the lack of pain or sadness or sorrow, but the fact that God is with us should bring peace into our hearts. We can still experience those emotions, but we have comfort in the very presence of God. The peace of the Lord be with you right now in this moment. Washes over your body in a way that someone that is of this world would not experience. So Jesus comes back again, says, peace be with you. And then he says to Thomas, you do the same as the disciples did last week. Put your hand here. Put it here in my side. And Thomas's response, he was transformed, I believe, in that moment, feeling the washing of the Spirit over and feeling that peace and the excitement of Jesus being present with him, and proclaims, my Lord and my God. Jesus then speaks in prophetic words. Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet come to believe. I believe Jesus was not chastising Thomas in that moment. Jesus was elevating those who would not have this particular experience to speak of the faith that they would have despite not having the privilege of being present in front of Jesus. Jesus wanted them to know, this is wonderful for you, but it's easier for you to believe because you're able to touch me, you're able to hear me, you're able to feel me, you're able to feel my breath blow upon you the way of God. But those who have none of those things and believe, they are blessed. They're not being deprived. They're not second class to these disciples. They are blessed. Then Jesus not only did that, but did many other signs in the presence of his disciples. Signs, things that point to Jesus, things that point to God. Not necessary, not things that had to be done so that this kingdom of God could continue to expand, but so that they might have the nourishment of faith that would help them in their journey. Jesus graciously, mercifully gives them this privilege of seeing even more signs. I think we all can identify with Thomas that we have our doubts. But I want to take away the structure that's been built around Thomas is that he was the only one that didn't believe. When in fact, the story that we just went over says that Jesus came and it was Jesus' suggestion for them to put the finger in the hole and the hand in the side. And that when Thomas heard it, he wanted that too. And when Jesus met with them, Jesus wanted them to know, people who don't even get to do this are blessed, and gave them more signs for their journey. I encourage you to look for the signs of God. How does God show you? How does God confirm? How does God tell you? Yes, this is what you should be doing. This is where I'm calling you in this season. Come and follow me. Don't be afraid. Don't be concerned about the distractions, the discomforts, or those things. Come and follow me, I will edify you through the gifting of the Holy Spirit for the work of at hand and for everything that you need. Jesus wants us to know that in this time of joy and celebration of resurrection, that God is doing this not simply so that we can be saved from a life apart, but because then we are equipped, encouraged, ignited, and sent to share that good news, that reality of resurrection promise with the whole world. May God bless you in this Easter season as your journey brings you to encounter those who never got to touch the hands or never got to touch the side, but yet will come to believe because of your witness. Amen.
Who taught the sun where to stand in the morning? Who told the ocean you can only come this far? And who showed the moon where to hide till evening? Whose words can catch a falling star? I know my Redeemer lives. I know my Redeemer lives. All creation testifies, this life within me cries. I know my Redeemer lives. The very same God spins things into orbit, runs to the weary, the worn and the weak, and the same gentle hands that hold me when I'm broken, they've conquered death and brought me victory. Now I know my Redeemer lives. I know my Redeemer lives. All creation testifies, this life within me cries. I know that my Redeemer take away my shame. My Redeemer lives, forever I'll proclaim. Payment for my sin was the precious life given, but now he's alive, empty grave. I know my Redeemer lives. I know my Redeemer lives. Let all creation testify, life within me cry. I know my Redeemer, my Redeemer lives.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting.
Alive in the risen Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. You shower your church with grace, O God. Unite the whole church on earth so that with one heart it testifies to the resurrection of Jesus Christ with power and love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. You proclaim the blessing of life forevermore. Like dew upon the mountains, refresh your creation, restore waters, cleanse the air, and provide revitalizing moisture to parched land. Give your whole creation the promise of new life. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You direct the nations, O God, guide all in authority, that they shepherd their peoples in the ways of your love. Defeat in us our impulse to war. Bestow the peace of Christ upon those in authority and breathe upon them the Holy Spirit. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. You place within the heart of the church a spirit of sharing. Give us the power of your generous spirit, that we provide for the needs of others. Announce your peace to those who are lonely, hurting, suffering, or afraid. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. You give us fellowship with one another in this faith community. Shine the light of the risen Christ in our life together so that we live in love for one another and our joy may be complete. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You share the gift of eternal life. In thanksgiving and remembrance, we recall the lives and gifts of those who now live in endless joy. Unite us with them in resurrection hope. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great.
In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
As we pause for our time of offering, we pause also in gratitude to you for your generous sharing of gifts throughout this over year-long pandemic, for supporting your congregations, and for stepping up in difficult times so that our congregations can be strong even as we go through this and even as we come out of this. We hope you'll take a bit of time to support your local congregation right now, but may we pray. God of love, you call us beloved children and welcome us to your table. Receive our lives and the gifts we offer. Abide with us and send us in service to a suffering world for the sake of your beloved child, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand and start to fall, for all those lonely roads that I've traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found,
Now may our glorious God grant you a spirit of wisdom to know and to love the risen Lord Jesus, the God of life, Creator, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Joy before him, rising up.
Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Go in peace, share the good news. Alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia.